A very good morning to all of you. Am I audible to all of you? Can someone confirm that, please? Okay. So let us get started. So today we would be covering the PIB summary from the 11th to 20th of July 2023. So let us quickly get started with what important news we have in for the PIB summary. Okay, I was not there in the office yesterday. Okay, that's why I was unable to take the class, but it was not being able to be rescheduled, that is why. Okay, so no issues, let us get started. What is the first news that is in news is regarding the performance on CP grams, that is the centralized public grievance redress and monitoring system. On this, with respect to performance, or we'll read with respect to performance on the CP grams with respect to central ministries and departments, and we'll also read the performance with respect to various states and union territories. So first of all, let us start with the performance of various central ministries and departments. So the central ministries and departments, they have been able to redress over 1 lakh grievances, to be precise, 1,02,348 grievances by various central ministries and departments in the month of June 2023. And if we consider the various departments or central ministries on the basis of that which ministry or department has performed better, then you can see here that the Department of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare and the Ministry of Cooperation, both of them have topped in the Group A category. Both of them have topped in the Group A category. Then Niti Aayog and Department of Public Enterprises, both of them have topped in Group B category. And if we see the performance of the various states and union territories, then in the month of June 2023, a total of 69,929 grievances were been able to be redressed. And if with respect to the northeastern states, with respect to northeastern states, Sikkim topped with respect to this grievance redressal. With respect to union territories, it was Lakshadweep which topped. And with respect to states with population of more than, sorry, not population, with more than 17,500 grievances, with respect to that, UP has topped. And with respect to states which have less than 17,500 grievances, Telangana has topped. Okay, and if we consider overall among the various states, overall which had the highest number of grievances and which also disposed the highest number of grievances, it was Uttar Pradesh. Okay, it is Uttar Pradesh. Okay, now let us come to the next news, which is regarding a scheme, that is Samarth scheme. So Samarth scheme, this is for capacity building in the textiles sector. Okay, capacity building in the textile sector under the Ministry of Textiles. And why this is in news? Because some data or data points or facts have come in news, that is 43 new implementing partners have been empaneled, and additional target of training around 75,000 beneficiaries has been allocated to various training partners. That is why it has come into news. And alongside that also, there is a slight change in the funding pattern, where there would be an increment of 5% in cost norms. So when this increment in funding would be given, it would give the additional financial support in the scaling program that is being done under the Samarth scheme. Okay, and we have already known that what is the Samarth scheme. It is under the Ministry of Textiles, and it is for capacity building in the field of or in the sector of textiles. Then we have the scheme of Women and Child Development Ministry under Nirbhaya Fund. So this under Nirbhaya fund, there is this scheme for critical care and support to POC, SO victims, basically the children who are victims to various harassment, sexual harassments that comes under this POCSO. And under this, a total cost of 74.10 crore rupees has been appraised. Then we have the Bharat campaign. So first of all, what is this Bharat campaign? This is an abbreviation, and whenever you have or whenever you see an abbreviation, it is important that you remember what is the expansion of the same. So the Bharat, that is banks heralding accelerated rural and agricultural transformation. So this is basically, this Bharat is a campaign, and what it is going to do, it is going to increase the various loans or various credit that is being given under the agricultural infrastructure fund. Under this agricultural infrastructure fund, you could say various credit is given, okay, various credit is provided for post harvest infrastructure, you could say post harvest infrastructure, and this helps in bringing up the infrastructure of the agricultural sector, okay. And with the help of this campaign, the Bharat campaign, that is going to be a month long, from 15th July to 15th August, it is expecting that it would be able to raise 7200 crore rupees through the campaign, okay. Then we have the IFSCA MOUs. So IFSCA, what is this IFSCA? It is the International Financial Services Centers Authority, okay, and it has signed various MOUs. So I have clubbed it in one place so you can, it would be easier for you to remember. So IFSCA has signed a memorandum of understanding or a MOU with Climate Policy Initiative, with Climate Policy Initiative for Global Sustainable Capital Flows to India. Then it has signed a MOU with IIM Lucknow. It has signed a MOU with IIM Lucknow for facilitating financial technology and tech fin entities. Then it has also signed a MOU with BITS Pilani. It has also signed a MOU with PIEDS BITS Pilani, and this is also for the same purpose as the MOU that has been signed with IIM Lucknow, that is supporting and facilitating fintech and techfin entities. Okay. Then let us go to the next news, that is ATR module of Audit Online, that is Action Taken Report of Audit Online. So first of all, what is this Audit Online? So Audit Online, it was launched in 2020, okay, launched in 2020 under Ministry of Panchayati Raj, okay, under Ministry of Panchayati Raj. And what is the purpose of this Audit Online? It is for online audit of panchayat accounts. So when we are having, or we are going to have online auditing of this panchayat accounts, then we are certainly going to see more transparency and accountability in the system, right? And that is why this Audit Online had come. But now there is another thing that has also been launched, that is the Action Taken Report module. So what is this Action Taken Report module? So basically all the actions that are being taken with respect to or with regard to this Audit Online, that is the Action Taken Report. So there is going to basically be a report regarding what actions have been taken to ensure that the online auditing of this panchayat accounts is being done properly, okay. And this is the Action Taken Report, and this has been recently launched, and this is by the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, and you can certainly understand this is for bringing more transparency and accountability, more transparency and accountability in the system. Then we have the Atal Vayo Abhyudaya Yojana, okay, or you can remember it in the short form as ABHAY, and this was introduced by the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. And what is this scheme associated with? It is associated with empowerment of senior citizens, okay, empowerment of senior citizens. And here the various contributions, invaluable contributions of senior citizens is appreciated, acknowledged, okay. That is exactly why this scheme has been launched or this scheme is in place. And there are few data that you need to remember here, or few facts you could say that you need to remember, that this scheme, This scheme is actually a revamped version of an earlier scheme that existed, that is the National Action Plan for Senior Citizen. This scheme has been revamped and renamed as ABHAY, and it was subsumed in 2021. And there are two sub programs or sub schemes under this ABHAY. One is the integrated program for senior citizens, where financial assistance is given, you could say, to organizations or institutions which are providing shelters or which are caring for the senior citizens. So they are going to be provided financial assistance so that they can provide better for the senior citizens. And during the last three financial years, with respect to this integrated program for senior citizens, 288 crore rupees of grants has already been given, and the number of beneficiaries who were benefited from this program is 363,570 beneficiaries, okay? And this is one of the sub schemes or sub programs under this ABHAY scheme. Then another component under this is the Rashtriya Vayoshri Yojana. So what happens under this Rashtriya Vayoshri Yojana? So the aged people or the senior citizen, they require various aids, various physical living aids, like you could say hearing aids or any sort of prosthetics that we require. So all of this is provided under the Rashtriya Vayoshri Yojana. And to whom it is provided? It is provided to senior citizens who are below poverty line, who are either below poverty line category or their income is up to 15,000 rupees per month. To them, various living aids or various aids are provided for their well-being. Okay, so since we are discussing here about the Rashtriya Vayoshri Yojana and the provision of providing them aids or physical living aids, so can someone tell me that which PSU, there is a particular PSU which provides them or which you could say manufactures this physical aids? So can someone tell me that which PSU we are talking about here? Okay, it would be ALIMCO. Okay, it would be ALIMCO, which provides this physical aids. Okay, and coming to your question regarding the sessions for ESI, I would say that for ESI, only this session would not be sufficient. You have to use the various materials that are going to be provided and various other sessions that are also going to be taken under this NABARD program. You have to club them all together, okay, for expecting a good score in NABARD. Then we have the various indexes or various indices. So first is the index of industrial production. So we have talked, whenever we talk about a okay, we'll come, I will come to all your queries at the end of the session. Okay, let us continue the session first. So the index of industrial production. So whenever you see an index, there are two important things that you need to remember. One is what is its base year, and another is who publishes it. Okay, these are the two important things, base year and who publishes it, which is a static part, you could say, and you should always, whenever you see any sort of indices like this, then you should remember it. So index of industrial production, so the base year of this is 2011-12, and who publishes it? It is published by NSO. It is published by NSO MOSPI. It is published by NSO MOSPI. Okay, and this is a monthly index, so whatever data you are getting, it gets revised for every month. You get updated data for every month. So here we have the data with respect to May 2023, for which the index of industrial production stood at 145. And another important thing about the IIP that you need to remember here is that there are 8 core industries. Okay, there are 8 core industries, and this 8 core industries constitute 40.27%. It constitutes 40.27% of the IIP. Okay, 40.27% of the IIP, and among these 8 core industries, refinery products has the highest weightage, and the fertilizer has the lowest weightage. Okay, this is what you need to remember here. Next, let us come to consumer price index or CPI. So here also two things again what we need to remember. One is base year, that is 2012, and who publishes it? It is published by the same institution or organization, that is NSO. And if we see the data here that has been given, that is with respect to June 2023, and this consumer price index that we are discussing here, as you can see, this data is CPI rural, urban and combined. This is rural, urban and combined. There is a different CPI for agricultural laborers and rural laborers, which has a different base year, and it is also published by a different institution. So do not get confused with the same, or do not organize the both of these facts. Okay, we are going to cover it in this document only. So with respect to June 2023, the index, if we see the combined data, it is 180.9, and if we see the inflation, CPI based inflation, then it is 4.81. Then we have the wholesale price index. And again here, what is the base year for the same? That has not been given here. Okay, and who publishes this? It is published by Ministry Commerce. It is published by the Ministry of Commerce, and the data for the month of June 2023 is given here, and the wholesale price index based inflation for June 2023 is minus 4.12%. Then let us go to the Indian exports in the month of June 2023. Indian exports in the month of June 2023. Yes, these are the, as Satya Sai Praveen has rightly said, these are the 8 core industries. You have rightly mentioned the 8 core industries. Then we have the India's export data, India's export data for the month of June 2023. So if we consider the overall, exports in the month of June 2023, then it is $60.09 billion. And then if we see the trade deficit, okay, trade deficit you can simply understand as the difference between import and export. So if the import is higher than the export, then we are in deficit. And if the exports are higher than the imports, then we are in surplus. Okay, so currently, as you can see, we are having a deficit. So we have more imports than exports, and the trade deficit for the month of June 2023, it has improved by 28.26% to $22.59 billion. And if we consider the merchandise trade deficit, then it has also improved by 7.9% to $57.6 billion. Okay, then you have certain data with respect to specific areas which you could just have a look at. Okay, then we have the MCA, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So Ministry of Corporate Affairs has recently withdrawn about 7000, or to be precise, 7338 prosecutions. So what will happen when this withdrawal is drawn of various prosecutions? Then there would be ease of doing business, because when there are various pending cases with the court, the ease of doing business is affected to a very large extent, to a very severely. And that is exactly why withdrawal of cases, which may be not as important when they are withdrawn, or when they are withdrawn, or when there is a withdrawal of the same, you can see that there is a better ease of doing business. And that is exactly why this procedure is being is being done. Okay, and with the withdrawal that has been done of various cases, you can see that there would be a 21.86% reduction in pending prosecutions. Then we have the export preparedness index. So whenever you have any sort of index report that you see, it is important for you to remember that who publishes the report or who publishes this index. So here you can see that the export preparedness index report, it is released or published by Niti Aayog. It is released or published by Niti Aayog, and here it is basically judging the performance of export preparedness on the basis of four primary pillars, that is policy, business ecosystem, export ecosystem and export performance. Okay, on the basis of these four broad pillars, the assessment is done with respect to export preparedness, and this four primary pillars have further 10 sub pillars on the basis of which this assessment is done. And on the basis of this report or index, the top position has been held by Tamil Nadu is the overall topper here, and the last position has been secured by Lakshadweep. The last position has been secured by Lakshadweep. And one of the important things that you need to remember here is because now in examinations, not only the first and last is asked, usually it is important that you remember the top five. Okay, so here you can see that who are the top five. It is Tamil Nadu, followed by Maharashtra, Karnataka, Gujarat and Haryana. Okay, these have secured the top five position. The top position is by Tamil Nadu and the last position has been secured by Lakshadweep. Okay, then we have the Artificial Intelligence for India 2.0. Artificial Intelligence for India 2.0. So this is Artificial Intelligence for India 2.0. It is basically a free online training program. It is a free online training program that was launched with respect to artificial intelligence, right? This training, and it was launched on the World Youth Skills Day on the 15th of July. And this Artificial Intelligence for India initiative and this program, training program that has been launched, it is a joint initiative of Skill India and GUVI. Joint initiative of Skill India and GUVI, and this GUVI is also a joint initiative, or you can say a collaboration of IIT Madras and NCVET. On the these two have collaborated to come up with this GUVI. So Skill India and GUVI, they have collaborated for this, or they have jointly initiated this program of Artificial Intelligence for India 2.0. Then we have the International Energy Agency. International Energy Agency. So it has recently launched an index, or you could say a report, that is Oil 2023 report. Okay, Oil 2023 medium term market report, that is known as the IEA Oil 2023 Supply and Demand Dynamics to 2028. Okay, and this has been launched by the International Energy Agency, of course, and it is in collaboration with another organization or institution, you could say, that is Petroleum Planning and Analysis Cell, which is under the Ministry of Petroleum. So both of them, they have collaborated to come up with this report. So this, since this is a report, we have to see in some of the findings that have come up under this report. So you can see here that the overall consumption of petroleum products was at 223 million metric tons. It was at 223 million metric tons for the last year, and this was a growth of about 12% over the previous year. And if you see India's position in the world with respect to various areas, then you can see here that India is the world's fourth largest refiner. Okay, it has the fourth largest LNG terminal capacity, it is the fourth largest auto market, and also the third largest biofuels producer. Okay, so this you can say India's position with respect to the world in various scenarios or various industries. Then let us see what more findings have come up under this report. So here this has been focused on, that India, it has already achieved 12% of ethanol blending in petrol, and its target is to blend 20% ethanol blending in petrol by 2025. It is important that you remember this target, okay, 20% blending of ethanol by 2025. Then what are the other important findings under this report? So you can see here that alternate clean fuels like biofuels, they are expected to provide around 10% of new liquid fuel supply growth to 2028. So by 2028, we are expecting that alternate clean fuels would be contributing about 10% to the total new liquid fuel supply. And alongside that, biofuel production, it is expected that it is going to expand to a very large extent. So we are expecting that it is going to expand by or nearly 600 kb per day. So what does this mean? It is 600,000 barrels per day. 600,000 barrels per day, we are expecting it is going to expand by this much from 2022 to 2028. And this expansion that is going to happen, we are expecting that 70% of this expansion would be contributed by countries like Brazil, Indonesia and India combined. And then if we come to the investments, in oil and gas exploration, investments in oil gas exploration, it has also increased to a very large extent, and in fact it has reached the highest level since 2015, okay, that it is going at 11% year on year. And in 2023, the total investment that was done for oil and gas exploration is $528 billion for the year 2023. Okay, these are some of the important findings. Okay, these are some of the important findings under this oil report, oil 2023 report. Then let us go to the next report, which is also an important report, that is the National Multidimensional Poverty Index, okay, a progress review 2023. So here another index or report, you could say. So it is important that you remember who publishes this report or who has published this report. So it has been published by Niti Aayog. It has been published by Niti Aayog, and all of the data that has been given under this index or report, it has been extracted, or this is based on the National Family Health Survey 5. National Family Health Survey 5 that was conducted between 2019 to 2021. On the basis of that, this report or index has come up, and this index or report that has come up, it is the second edition. It is the second edition of the report, okay. And here, as you can see, it is about multidimensional poverty. So here, on the basis of primarily three pillars or three dimensions, all of this data is given. So can someone tell me what are the three broad dimensions on the basis of which this index has been prepared? What are the three main dimensions on the basis of which this report or index has been prepared? Can someone tell? Yes, health, then, okay, yes, health, education and family standard, or you can say standard of living, okay, standard of living, health, education and standard of living. This is the three primary pillars on the basis of which this index has been prepared. And this primary dimensions, three primary dimensions, this also has sub dimensions, which is 12 sub pillar or sub dimensions, you could say, on the basis of which this index has been prepared. Now let us see the findings of this report or index. So according to this report, between the financial year of 2016 to financial year of 2021, 13.5 crore Indians, they were able to escape multidimensional poverty in this 5 years, okay, between 2015-16 to 2019-21. And between this two or this 5 years, that is 15-16 and 2021, there was a decline of 9.89% points or percentage points with respect to India's multidimensionally poor people. So in 15-16 it was around 25%, and now it is 14.96%. It is 14.96%. The rural areas they saw fastest decline in poverty, and it was somewhere above 30%, but now it has come down below 20% to 19.28%. Then in the same period with respect to urban areas, there was also a reduction in poverty to 5.27%, but as you can see that the intensity of decrease in the poverty has been much higher in the rural areas, from over 30% to less than 20%. Then the multidimensional poverty index value, it has also halved. It has also halved to 0.066. It has decreased or halved to 0.066, and the intensity of poverty, it has reduced from 47% to 44%. Okay, it is more important that you remember the present values. Okay, not all old values are important, though you might have an idea regarding the same, but it is important that you remember the current values that are being given. Then there was substantial improvement across all 12 MPI indicators. We learned there are three primary dimensions, and under it there are indicators, 12 MPI indicators. So across all of them there was improvement. And with respect to states, you can see that Uttar Pradesh, it registered the highest decline in the number of poor people. It experienced the highest decline in this multidimensionally poor people. Then some other facets of this MPI also regarding sanitation. So there is a 21.8% points improvement with respect to sanitation deprivations, and there was a 14.6% point improvement with respect to cooking fuel deprivation. So in this two, there was a improvement, a very good improvement of 21.8% points and 14.6% points. Okay, so these are some of the important findings under this report or index that you should remember. Okay, kindly give me a minute, please. Okay, then we have the another, not exactly a report, this is primarily a framework, and you would see that in this document there are various reports, indices or frameworks that has been launched by Niti Aayog. Okay, so this has also been launched by Niti Aayog. So what is this framework? It is Techno-Commercial Readiness and Market Maturity Matrix Framework. And why this framework has been launched by Niti Aayog? It is to increase the innovation and entrepreneurship environment in India. Okay, and this framework has been launched by or released by Niti Aayog. It has been launched or released by Niti Aayog. Okay. Then we have extension of registration date for star rating. So here, what the coal mines, basically they are going to do, they are going to do self-evaluation, and on the basis of that they are going to give a rating to their own self. And the top 10% of the mines, they are going to be evaluated more properly by the authorities, and the rest 90%, they will be having a online review. So this is basically, you can understand, to ensure or to know the quality of the various mines, and for that a self-evaluation is being going to be done by the various mines. And for this self-evaluation registration, it has been extended. So earlier it was 15th July and it was extended to 25th July. Okay. Okay. Then we have quality control orders. The DPIIT under Ministry of Commerce, it has notified two new quality control orders with respect to resin treated compressed wood laminates and insulated flask bottles containers for domestic use. With regard to this two sectors, quality control orders have been notified and various modifications have been done, and various aspects or industries or sub industries under it has been given mandatory. It has been given mandatory certification that needs to be done. Okay. Then we'll go to the next news. That is a seminar, a national seminar on delivery of CSC services through primary agricultural credit societies. So, primary agricultural credit societies, what they do, they provide short to medium term loans, short to medium term agricultural loans to farmers, and other than that also they are invested in various economic activities, right? They are diversifying their businesses by undertaking various business activities, and under it one of the entry would be of delivery of CSC services. CSC services is common service center services. Common service centers, and here there are various services, various basic services with respect to e-governance, health, education, telemedicine. All of this are provided, okay, under this CSC, and this seminar was with respect to that only. That delivery of CSC products is now going to be also done through the primary agricultural credit societies. Primary agricultural credit societies, okay. And you can see here that till now 17,000 packs they have already on board with respect to the CSC portal, out of which 6,000 packs are going to start providing services as CSCs or common service centers. And currently if we see regarding the common service centers, there are over 5 lakh common service centers that are functioning around the whole country. Okay, it is over 5 lakh common service centers. Okay. Then we have the steel slag road technology. So, what is this steel slag? Steel slag is basically a waste product. It is a waste product of the steel industry. And what we are basically doing is, we are working on this waste of steel industry, that is steel slag, and we are using it in construction, or we are using it for construction purposes. Construction purposes for building roads, and here the steel slag road technology is what has come into news. So you can see here that India is second largest with respect to steel production. Okay, we are the second largest steel producing country, and recently the first road made with steel slag technology, steel slag road technology, happened to be in Surat, Gujarat. Okay, this is the first road made with steel slag road technology, steel slag road technology. Okay, and if you see other places where this steel slag is being used, you can see here in Arunachal Pradesh also the BRO had used, then in highway, National Highway 66. And this technology, who has developed this technology? It has been developed by the Central Road Research Institute. The Central Road Research Institute has come up with this technology, or it has developed this technology. Okay. Then we have the Ministry of Textiles Chintan Shivir. So Chintan Shivir, this is being conducted for various ministries, right? This is being conducted for various ministries where there is being a review. There is a review going on regarding the proceedings of the ministry, what it is doing, what are its targets, and this is related to the Ministry of Textiles. And in the Chintan Shivir that they recently had, they have reiterated that they have a target to produce textiles worth $250 billion, $250 billion, and they're also targeting to export $100 billion of textiles by 2030. Okay, then we'll come to nuclear energy. So the present installed nuclear power capacity in the country, what is it? It is 7480 megawatt, comprising of 23 nuclear power reactors. Okay, and this nuclear power reactors, they have generated 46 thousand, or you could say nearly 47,000 million units of electricity they have already generated the same in the year 22-23. And this nuclear power that is being generated, or that was generated in 22-23, it makes up about 2.8% of the total electricity that was produced or that was generated in the country. Okay, then we'll come to an award. Okay, award related to or with respect to procurement through government e-marketplace portal. Through government e-marketplace portal, procurement is being done, right? Procurement, who does the procurement? By various governments, various departments of the governments, then various PSUs, they do the procurement under the government e-marketplace. And with respect to this procurement only, an award has been given, or some awards have been given, which have been backed by some ministries. So here you can see that Ministry of Coal, it has been awarded in the best engagement category. In the best engagement category, it has won an award. Then Coal India Limited, it has been awarded as the Rising Star, and the NLC India Limited, it has been awarded with the Timely Payments category, under the Timely Payments category. Okay, and this government e-marketplace, you must be aware that it was launched in 2016, right? And there is also a target that is given under it, that 25% of procurement should be done from MSMEs, 4% from SC, ST, 3% women. Okay, and this 4% and 3%, this is within the MSME, 25% target of MSME only. Okay, it is regarding, it is, okay, you can see here, it is with respect to the procurement through the government e-marketplace portal, okay. And there are three awards, three categories, awards on the basis of three categories that has been given. Ministry of Coal has been given in the best engagement category. It has been awarded. Coal India Limited has been awarded as the Rising Star. And the NLC India, it has been awarded the Timely Payments category. Under the Timely Payments category, it has been awarded. Okay. Okay. Next is the Heat Index. Next is the Heat Index. So the IMD, Indian Meteorological Department, it has come up with an experimental heat index, you could say, on the basis of various temperatures. It has come up with color codes for various temperatures. So you can see here that if the temperature is less than 35 degrees centigrade, it is green, or the color code that is being given is green. Yellow is being given for the temperature range of 36 to 45 degrees centigrade, orange 46 to 55, and red for beyond 55 degrees centigrade. Okay, IMD has come up with this color coding scheme, or the heat index, you could say, because there is been climate change, there is global warming. So it is important that we keep a track of the temperature changes, the temperature increase, and this color code is going to be very beneficial in the same. Then we have the credit guarantee scheme for livestock sector. So first ever credit guarantee scheme for livestock sector has been launched, and this is going to certainly boost the MSME sectors, right? Credit guarantee, you understand that when the borrower is unable to pay back their debt, the borrower is unable to pay back their debt, then it would be covered by the credit guarantee. There is a credit guarantee fund that is going to be created, and it is going to cover in case there is a default by the borrower. And it is usually this credit guarantee, it is being given for the MSMEs. Okay, it is usually for the MSMEs. So let us see here, the credit guarantee scheme is implemented, or is being implemented, under the Animal Husbandry Infrastructure Development Fund, right? And here interest subvention of 3% is going to be given. Loans would be given for up to 90% of the total project cost. And a credit guarantee fund trust, right? It is important, a credit guarantee fund or trust is being created to cover up the defaults, right? So here a credit guarantee fund trust is going to be created of 750 crore rupees, and this would provide guarantee coverage of up to 25% of the credit facilities that is extended to the MSMEs by the eligible lending institutions. Okay, it is the this credit guarantee, it is not given to any borrower for that matter, but it is specifically credit that has been extended to the MSMEs. Okay. Okay. Now let us go to the next news, that is regarding CPI. This is what I was telling. This is CPI. We learnt CPI, rural, urban and combined. And this is the CPI, agricultural laborers and rural laborers. This has a different base year, that is 1986-87, and this is released by the Labor Bureau. Okay, this is released by the Labor Bureau, and let us see the data with respect to the CPI for the agricultural laborers and rural laborers for the month of June 2023. It is 1196 for agricultural laborers and 1207 for rural laborers. Okay, and if we consider the inflation based on this CPI for AL and CPL for RL, then it would be for the CPI, the inflation based on the CPI agricultural laborer is 6.31%, and the inflation with respect to CPI rural laborers is 6.16%, and all of this data is with respect to June 2023. Okay, June 2023, all of this data comes every month, so you need to update yourself that what is the latest value or data that you have in with respect to various indices that you see. Then you have the EPFO payroll data, the EPFO payroll data. So here I would be focusing on two important facts here, that in the month of May 2023, the EPFO, it added 16.3 lakh net members. It added 16.3 lakh net members, and if we consider with respect to various states, then it was Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Haryana and Gujarat, which were the top 5 states with respect to addition through this EPFO. Okay, with respect to net member addition that happened through this EPFO. Then we have the Nayi Manzil scheme. So Nayi Manzil scheme is for the minority, is for minority youth who lack formal education. Okay, either they lack formal education or they do not have any certification for the education that they have acquired. So what is going to happen through this Nayi Manzil scheme? They are going to be given skilling, or they are going to be given industry relevant, time and industry relevant scheme, so that they can get employed. So here you can see that Ministry of Minority Affairs, it launched this central sector scheme, that was Nayi Manzil scheme, in 2015, and 50% of the funding is going to come from the World Bank. It is going to come from the World Bank, and as we discussed, minority youth who do not have formal school leaving certificate. So either they do not have a formal education, or they do not have any certificate, formal certificate for the same. And this scheme, it is going to provide a combination of both formal education and also skills. Okay. Then we have the India Energy Security Scenario 2047. So this has also been launched by Niti Aayog. And what is this that has been launched? It is India Energy Security Scenario 2047. And what is this? What is this thing that we are talking about? It is analytical tools. Okay, these are analytical tools for managing climate change and also exploring net zero pathways, for exploring the same, for being able to manage the climate change that is happening, and also exploring various pathways in which we can be a net zero economy or net zero country. Various analytical tools have been released, okay, under this India Energy Security Scenario 2047. And who has released this? It has been released by Niti Aayog. It has been released by Niti Aayog. Okay. Okay. Then we have the India Climate Energy Dashboard. India Climate Energy Dashboard. This has also been released or launched by the Niti Aayog only. Okay, this has been launched by Niti Aayog and it is a user friendly platform. It is 3.0, right? It is the third version of the dashboard that has been created, and here anyone can have access to various data sets that are available with respect to climate and energy, and here they can use, right, various data sets that are available, they can be accessed by the public and analyzed the way they want it. Okay. So then we are going to learn some important news from the prelims perspective. So when we are going to cover this important news from the perspective of prelims, we are going to focus more on the facts, okay? Because in your preliminary examination, though now things are changing and you are getting more descriptive, but these facts are also important, that it is important, okay? So let us start with the first news. One is Ker Puja. So this Ker Puja, which state it is related to? It is an annual festival which is celebrated in the state of Tripura. It is celebrated in the state of Tripura. Then you have a defense exercise. You have a defense exercise that is ZIMEX 2023. That is ZIMEX 2023. So whenever you see any sort of defense exercise that is being conducted, it is important that you remember between which two countries it is being conducted and where it is being conducted. Okay, between which two countries. Or it is not necessarily always that any defense exercise is conducted between two specific countries. It could be more countries also. So whoever are the members of the exercise and where it is being conducted. So ZIMEX, it is between Japan and India. Okay, Japan and India. This is the maritime exercise that is being conducted. And where it was done? In the Bay of Bengal. It was hosted by India and it was conducted in the Bay of Bengal. Then National Fish Farmers Day Meet. National Fish Farmers Day Meet, where it was conducted? It was conducted in Mahabalipuram. Then the G20 Conference on Crime and Security. G20 Conference on Crime and Security in the Age of NFT, AI and Metaverse. So where it was conducted? In Gurugram. Third G20 Culture Working Group Meeting. It was conducted in Hampi, Karnataka. Fourth G20 Energy Transition Working Group Meeting. It was conducted in Goa. Then we have the G20 Global Food Regulators Summit, which was conducted in Delhi. Then the third G20 Finance Ministers and Central Bank Governors Meeting. It was conducted in Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Then we have the fourth G20 Employment Working Group Meeting. It was conducted in Indore. Then we have the fourth Energy Transition Working Group Meeting, which was conducted in Goa. Then we have Safeguarding Citizens' Interest in Financial Frauds Webinar that was conducted. So who collaborated to conduct this webinar? It was CEERA NLSIU Bangalore with collaboration or association with Department of Justice. Then we have a news regarding state disaster response. Okay, so to various state governments, to be precise 22 state governments, there has been a release of 7532 crore rupees by the center for various states for fulfilling their needs for disaster response. Then we have the National Tea Plantation Drive, National Tree Plantation Drive, and where it was organized. It was organized in Tirupati. And who organized it? It was organized by NHAI. Okay. Then let us go to the next news, which is Sagar Sampark. And what is this? Sagar Sampark, it is under the Ministry of Ports and it is Differential Global Navigation Satellite System for strengthening our maritime sector, okay? And this is a made in India system. This is made in India. This is something that has been developed by our own country. Then we have the Grand Cross of Legion of Honor. So what is this honor? So it is the highest honor of France, okay? Highest honor or honorable award that is given in France, and it has been given to our Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi. Then we have the Conference on Traditional Medicines that was recently conducted, and who collaborated to organize this conference? It was Ministry of Ayush, Ministry of External Affairs, and the ASEAN Secretariat. All of this, they collaborated for the Conference on Traditional Medicines. Then we have the Ministry of Defense and FSSI. They have signed a MOU or Memorandum of Understanding for what? To promote the use of millets and healthy eating practice among the armed forces. Okay, among the armed forces, for that Ministry of Defense and FSSI, they have signed a MOU. Then we have a news regarding coal gasification. So the Ministry of Coal, it has set a target with respect to coal gasification, and it is targeting coal gasification of 100 million tons of coal by financial year of 2030. 100 million ton by 2030. And the total outlay for this target is, or for achieving this target is 6,000 crore rupees. Okay. Then you have the another MOU that has been signed by the Ministry of Education. So let us see who have signed this MOU. It has been signed by the Ministry of Education and the PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Both of them, they have signed a MOU for Vidyanjali. For Vidyanjali, which is a school volunteer management program. So which is basically going to strengthen the system of schools, government schools, and it is with the help of the participation of the community. Okay. Then we have another MOU that has been signed by the Ministry of Roads and Japan. Ministry of Roads and Japan, or the MORTH and JICA, that is Japan International Cooperation Agency. And why they have signed this MOU? It is for creation of road infrastructures in the mountainous regions. Okay. Then we have Namda Craft of Kashmir. So here there are two things that you should remember. First of all, to which area this craft is associated with. So you can see here that is, it is associated with Kashmir, and currently this is being revived. This is being revived under the Skill India's pilot project, and it is the Skill India pilot project. It is a part of Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana. Okay. Then we have IIT Delhi. So IIT Delhi is going to establish its first campus outside India in Abu Dhabi. Okay, in Abu Dhabi it is going to establish its campus. It has signed a MOU or Memorandum of Understanding for the same reason. Okay, then we have Nomadic Elephant. This is also a military or exercise or armed exercise, and you can see here that this is being conducted between India and Mongolia, and where in this year where it is being conducted, it is in Ulaanbaatar, Mongolia. Okay, then we have a hackathon, third edition of Singapore India Hackathon. So who have collaborated for conducting this hackathon? It is India and Singapore, and to be precise, it is Ministry of Education, AICTE under Ministry of Education, and the University of Singapore, NTU, University of Singapore. They have collaborated for conducting this hackathon, and in this hackathon there are certainly some winners. This was a competition, so there are winners. So there are three universities you can see here, that is the NTU, Amity University and Dwarkadas College of Engineering, who have topped with respect to a tool that was created to detect potential suspects of insider trading. With respect to this, whatever development or tool they had created, it has been awarded, or they are the top position holders. Then with respect to startup category, the top winner is Hak Darshak. Okay. Then we have World Snake Day. So here, whenever you see a day, it is important that you remember the date on which it is observed. That is 16th of July 2023. And if you have any sort of associated theme for the day, for that specific year, okay? Then we have the 25th Asian Athletics Championship. So in this 25th Asian Athletics Championship 2023, Indian athletes, they own around 27 medals. They own 27 medals in this championship. Then we have the Bharat Dal. So here, this is basically subsidized, okay, it is a brand name Bharat Dal, under which subsidized Chana Dal is going to be sold, okay. Then we have the World Future Skills Award 2023. So who has received this award, World Future Skills Award 2023? It is NTPC. It is NTPC who has received this award, okay? And why it has received this award? It is for best use of artificial intelligence, augmented reality, virtual reality in learning and upskilling, and best advance in creating an extended enterprise learning program. Okay, in these two categories, or for these two projects, the NTPC, it has won this World Future Skills Award 2023. Okay, then the Surat Diamond. So this is the world's largest office building, which happened to be constructed in Surat, Gujarat. Then return of traffic antiquities. So USA, it has returned 105 trafficked antique objects that it has trafficked from India. It has returned the same to the various countries that it had trafficked. Then we have an appointment of Invest India, who has been appointed as the MD CEO. It is Nivruti Rai, who has been appointed as the MD CEO of Invest India. Then we have the Regional Office of Universal Postal Union. So Regional Office of Universal Postal Union has been launched in our country only, and it was recently inaugurated. Then we have the Festival of Libraries. It was recently conducted in New Delhi. Then we have Tankai method. So what do we mean by this? It is an ancient stitched shipbuilding method, which is known as Tankai method. I might be pronouncing it wrong. And it is the Ministry of Culture and Indian Navy who have signed a MOU to revive this method. Then you have the ammunition cum torpedo cum missile barge. So this has been recently launched, right? Then we have another appointment for the Director General of Indian Coast Guard. And who has been appointed? It is DG Rakesh Pal. It is DG Rakesh Pal who has been appointed as the Director General of Indian Coast Guard. Then we have the third working group on military cooperation of Indian-Russian Intergovernmental Commission. So where it was conducted? It was conducted or organized or held in New Delhi. Okay. Then we have the International Symposium on Sustainable Livestock Transformation. So this was basically inaugurated in the or under the Agricultural Working Group of G20 that was being organized in Anand. This is the place where the symposium on sustainable livestock transformation was organized or inaugurated. Then we have a trek transfer arrangement. So the National Innovation Foundation, it has signed a tech transfer arrangement with India Genomics. It has signed National Innovation Foundation, India Genomics. They have signed a MOU for ensuring quality in medicinal products. Okay. Then we have the Clean Energy Ministerial. So there are two, in fact, ministerial meetings that was conducted in Goa that you can see here. One is the 14th Clean Energy Ministerial and 8th Mission Innovation. Both of this were conducted or organized in Goa. Then we have the last news for today, that is Seva Bhoj scheme. So what is this scheme here? You can say charitable and religious institutions or organizations who distribute food for free. Their GST, the central part or portion of GST, is reimbursed under the Seva Bhoj scheme. So here you can see that 466 lakh rupees of GST collection was reimbursed during the last 3 years under this scheme. Okay, and here under this, which the central portion, the central GST and the central portion of the IGST, both of this are reimbursed. Okay. Okay, and not all charitable and religious institutes are eligible for the same. There are certain criteria that the religious institution should be established at least this year's ago. They should be distributing foods from this year ago. And there are some certain criteria on the basis of which the eligibility is established. And the GST, the central portion of GST, is returned or reimbursed under the scheme, Seva Bhoj scheme. Okay. And with this, we come to an end of the document from 11th to 12th. Okay, no issues. Obviously, there are so many facts. It is certainly that you will get confused, and we are going to cover this. We are going to first cover the backlog that is there from 11 to 20 and 21 to 31. We are going to cover it in bulk, and then we are planning to cover it in 2 days. Just like you are saying, we are going to cover it in 2 days. Okay, but currently we are going to, for one or two sessions, we are going to cover 10 days at a time. Okay, so don't worry about that. And okay then, okay, so with this we come to an end of this session, and we will be meeting again to discuss more of important news that is coming up in PIB. And I hope all of you have a very good day. Thank you.